Pancha kalpa through bis chauki bis indu bhava chauki tita nam pavena bhiyo vaishna bhava nam maha. So Maharaj just gave a PowerPoint presentation, but I'm going to read directly from Chaitanya Charitamrita, and if we have time, I'll read a little bit from the Chaitanya Bhagavat, which is a similar work, but it has more story and less philosophy. More passed on and less philosophy, but it's like a companion volume because it's all the Leela of Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda and their associates. And Prabhupada, it's bona fide, Prabhupada wanted us to read it. I just didn't have time to translate everything. So many books he would have translated had he had time, like Mahabharata and Ramayana and different works by the Acharyas. So Raghunath Das Goswami, he had a father and an uncle, and they were called Haranya and Govardhan Majumada. So this is based initially at their house, and then you'll see the storyline. At the house of Haranya and Govardhan Majumada, a person named Gopal Chakravati was officially the chief tax collector. Even in those days they had to pay taxes. This Gopal Chakravati lived in Bengal. His duty as chief tax collector was to collect 1,200,000 coins to deposit in the treasury of the emperor. He had handsome bodily features, and he was learned and youthful, but he could not tolerate the statement that simply by glimpsing the awakening of the Lord's holy name, one can attain liberation. So it seems that he's a brahmana, and he's acting as a tax collector, but it would seem, because he was learned, and he was upset over this philosophical point of liberation being awarded to somebody who merely chants the holy name. He was obviously inclined to Maya Bhav. Prabhupada's purport. Vaishnavas strictly follow the directions of the Shastras regarding how one can be liberated simply by a slight awakening of pure chanting of the holy name. Does everybody understand what that means? By chanting you become liberated? Whereas the Mayavadis, they, for many, many lifetimes, they try to become one with the Brahman, attain liberation from the modes of nature. But a devotee achieves that very easily by chanting. Because the Mayavadis don't want to surrender to Krishna, so they try another method. Mayavadis cannot tolerate the statements of how the Shastra, of the Shastras about how easily liberation can be achieved. For as stated in Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada, impersonalists must work hard for many, many births, and then only will perhaps they be liberated. Vaishnavas know that simply by chanting the holy name of the Lord offenselessly, one achieves liberation as a byproduct. Thus there is no need to endeavor separately for liberation. Srila Bilvaman of Thakura said, Mukti Swayam Mukuli Tanjali Sevatesma. Liberation stands at one's door, ready to render any kind of service if one is a pure devotee with unflinching faith and reverence. So liberation is a person, huh? Person, female, person. So she wants to serve devotees. In other words, we don't have to worry about liberation. We don't have to make any separate endeavor. If we follow the process, if we follow Srila Prabhupada, who's way more than liberated, Mahapurush, Mahabharat, we're liberated. if we nicely follow Prabhupada. Okay. The Mayavadis cannot tolerate this. The devotee becomes liberated so easily. Therefore, the Arinda Pradhan, the chief tax collector, although very learned, handsome, and youthful, could not tolerate the statements of Haridas Thakur. This young man, Gopal Chakravarti, became very angry upon hearing the statements of Haridas Thakur, because Haridas Thakur was glorifying the holy name, saying it's by chanting you become liberated. And this Gopal Chakravarti had heard it, and he was angry, throwing things on the floor. He immediately criticized Haridas. "Oh, assembly of learned scholars," he said, "just hear the conclusions of the emotional devotee." Because that's what the Mayavadis would think. They think, oh, these people are crazy. They're just emotionally singing songs and dancing in the street. They should be studying Vedanta. This is all their nonsense. So Gopal Chakravarti continues. "After many millions upon millions of births, when one is complete in absolute knowledge, one may not attain liberation, yet this man says that one may attain it simply by the awakening of a glimpse of the holy name." So he just doesn't agree. He doesn't agree with the glories of the holy name, and he doesn't agree with Haridas Thakur, and he wants to fight. Haridas said, "Why are you doubtful? The revealed scriptures say that one can attain liberation simply by a glimpse of the offenseless chanting of the holy name. For a devotee who enjoys the transcendental bliss of devotional service, liberation is most insignificant. Therefore, pure devotees never desire to achieve liberation. My dear Lord, O Master of the Universe, since I have directly seen you, my transcendental bliss has taken the shape of a great ocean. Being situated in that ocean, I now realize all of the so-called happiness, including even Brahmanda, to be like the water contained in the hoofprint of a calf." So Haridas is quoting this shloka. The transcendental bliss is so great, like an ocean. But the Brahmanda, which is what the Mayavadis are seeking, is like the water contained in the hoofprint of a calf. So you can imagine Gopal Chakravarti didn't like this. Gopal Chakravarti said, "If one is not liberated by Namabhas, then you may be certain that I shall cut off your nose." So he's threatening to cut off Haridas Thakur's nose. Because he doesn't believe. So he said, "If what you're saying is not true, I'll cut your nose off." And Haridas accepted the challenge offered by Gopal Chakravarti. "If by Namabhas liberation is not available, certainly I shall cut off my nose." He will cut his nose off himself. "I will cut my nose off." So he's very confident, of course, he's confident that the Shastra is correct. All the members of the assembly who had heard the challenge were greatly agitated, and they got up making a tumultuous noise. Arani and Govardhan and Majumar both immediately chastised the Brahmin and tax collector. They were completely embarrassed. This man was behaving so badly, arguing with Haridas Thakur, who was highly esteemed by everyone. So they chastised him. The priest named Balaramacharya chastised Gopal Chakravarti. "You are a foolish logician. What do you know about the devotional service of the Lord? You have insulted Haridas Thakur. Thus there will be a dangerous position for you. You should not expect anything auspicious." So he made a big Vaishnava parata. If we offend a devotee, we can expect something very bad to happen. Then Haridas got up to leave. And the Majumdars, the masters of Gopal Chakravarti, because they were employing Gopal Chakravarti, they immediately dismissed Gopal Chakravarti from their service. So they threw him out of his job. his ill fortune began. With all the members of the assembly, the two Majumat Mars fell at the lotus feet of Haridasa Thakura. But they wanted to apologize for this bad behavior of their employee. But Haridasa was not upset. Haridasa was smiling, however, and he spoke in a sweet voice. "None of you are at fault," he said. "Indeed, even this ignorant so-called Brahmana is not at fault, for he is accustomed to dry speculation and logic." So Haridasa was just transcendental to the whole thing, completely undisturbed. And then he says, quotes a verse, "One cannot understand the glories of the holy name simply by logic and argument. Therefore this man cannot possibly understand the glories of the holy name." So Haridasa understands that because this man is not a devotee of Krishna, he can't understand the power of the holy name. It's an insider's information. Yeah, it's like what they call an open secret. It's something that everybody can, theoretically, everybody can get the information, but only somebody who practices devotional service can really understand. So Haridasa says, "All of you may now go to your homes. May Lord Krishna bestow his blessings upon you. Do not be sorry because of my being insulted." So Prabhupada, he says, from this statement by Haridasa Thakura, it is understood that a pure Vaishnava never takes anyone's insults seriously. This is the teaching of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Trinada Pisunichina, Tarora Pisunichina, Amalina Amadana, Kadamiya, Sadhari. One should chant the holy name of the Lord in a humble state of mind, thinking oneself lower than the straw in the street. One should be more tolerant than a tree, devoid of all sense of false prestige, and ready to offer all respects unto others. It doesn't say all respects unto other devotees, it says all respects unto others. It means everybody. In such a state of mind, one can chant the holy name of the Lord constantly. A Vaishnava is always tolerant and submissive, like trees and grass. He tolerates insults offered by others, for he is simply interested in chanting the holy name of the Lord without being disturbed. See, a devotee doesn't get sidetracked. You know, somebody comes along and insults you and makes big problems. You just let it go. Don't fight, don't get involved, don't go down to their level. Because you've got your sadhana, you've got your consciousness. You just want to keep on track. You don't want to be falling down into the material energy with them. Okay, then Haridasa, Madhumada, returned to his home and ordered that Gopal Chakravarti not be admitted therein. Don't let that man in. Within 3 days, that Brahmana was attacked by leprosy. So this Gopal, yeah, the one who did insult Haridasa, he was attacked by leprosy. And as a result, his highly raised nose melted away and fell off. So you can see this is poetic justice, because he was threatening to cut off Haridasa Thakura's nose. But in fact, it was him that had his nose removed. Yeah. I can imagine, you know, he's young and beautiful, he's attached, his nice body, and his nose has disappeared. Oh, it must be like two holes, isn't it? And when you see a skull, it's just two holes, and the nose is gone. Yuck. The Brahmana's toes and fingers were beautiful, like golden champaka buds, but because of leprosy, they all withered and gradually melted away, so he lost his fingers and his toes as well. Seeing the condition of Gopal Chakravarti, everyone was astonished. They knew what had happened, and everybody could see the connection. Everyone praised the influence of Haridasa Thakura and offered him obeisances. So this is an interesting point now. Although Haridasa Thakura as a Vaishnava did not take seriously the Brahmana's offense, the Supreme Personality of Godhead could not tolerate it. And thus he made the Brahmana suffer the consequences. So Haridasa didn't think anything of it. It's okay, I don't mind. He didn't know what he was talking about. But Krishna did not like it at all when his devotee was insulted. Krishna said, okay, leprosy, you don't attack that puffed up man. A characteristic of a pure devotee is that he excuses any offense by an ignorant rascal. The characteristic of Krishna, however, is that he cannot tolerate blasphemy of his devotees. Okay, so that's the lesson from that leela. So now I'm going to read a little bit from Chaitanya Bhagavat. Unless anybody has a comment, something, feel inspired to say, it's okay. So, I think Maharaj must have mentioned that Haridasa was put in prison. He was thrown in prison because the the Muslims were very upset with him, and also the Hindus were very upset because he was born Mohammedan or Muslim, but he was acting like a Hindu. That's what they saw externally. They understood, why is this Haridas chanting Hare Krishna behaving like a Hindu? He should be following the Quran, should be behaving like a proper Muslim. And the Hindus also were saying, he's not born a Hindu, how can you do these things? It's all just a disturbance. So they complained to the Nawab, who was like, I don't know, it's like a local authority. The local Mohammedan authorities, known as the Qazi, became envious of Haridas' popularity. So he was envious, everybody was admiring Haridas, he was getting praised, he was getting following. People can be envious about all sorts of things. So he said this, Qazi complained to the Nawab, this man is acting like a Hindu. Arrest him and punish him. These were the words of the sinful Qazi, and they sparked an immediate response from the equally envious and sinful Nawab. Haridas Thakur was thus arrested. But because he had received the mercy of Lord Krishna, he had no fear of the Mohammedan authorities or even of death itself. So he was fearless. That's a quality of a pure devotee. Prabhupada exhibited that. He was fearless. Fearless to go to America on his own, and fearless to speak absolute truth to very materialistic people. They can become very angry when they hear the truth of that they're sinful and they're going to suffer. What their sense gratification is nonsense. People get quite upset. Okay, so he was fearless. Haridas appeared before the Nawab. When the devotees and other pious persons in the vicinity of the Nawab's palace heard that Haridas had been arrested, they were horrified. Oh no, what are they going to do to Haridas? Because they know that Mohammedans can be, or any authorities can be very heavy if people are doing what they don't want them to do. Previously, many religious persons have been arrested and imprisoned by the Mohammedans. These arrested people were very happy at the thought that Haridas was joining them. So they were arrested and they were in the prison. They said, oh, Haridas Thakur's coming to the prison too. Oh, very good. We will have good association. They were confident that his presence would give them relief from their miserable condition. Maybe we'll be able to have a prison if Haridas is here. Maybe we'll get some blessings. Indeed, the prisoners requested that the wardens allow them unrestricted association with Haridas. When Haridas was brought into the prison, he looked at all the prisoners with compassion as they offered obeisances at his lotus feet. His long, graceful arms had extended to his knees, his lotus eyes and his moon-like face charmed everyone. As they offered respects to the saintly devotee, love for Krishna stirred in their hearts. So just by seeing him, they became more devotional. Being very pleased with the prisoners, Haridasa blessed them by saying, "Just remain as you are." As a stranger, they're in the prison, they're suffering, and Haridasa tells them to remain as they are. He didn't say, "No, I guess you will be able to get out of the prison and go back to your lives." The sense of gratification. No, he says, "Remain as you are." The prisoners could not grasp the proper meaning of this, however, and so they became dejected. "Oh no, we've stayed in this prison?" Haridasa could see the misunderstanding, so he compassionately explained, "Please do not feel sad, for I could never wish you any misfortune. What I mean to say is this, I hope that the love for Krishna you now feel may always remain. For now, chant Krishna's holy name and constantly remember his pastimes, thus inspiring one another to attain devotion." Violence and tyranny are absent in the spiritual world, so you should sincerely cry out for Krishna's help and continually think of him. When you are released from this prison, do not return to your former materialistic ways. Do not associate with sinful and degraded persons, for one can never cultivate love for Krishna by living a mundane life. So he's preaching to them. You should know for certain that Krishna is unobtainable for a materialistic person. Materially engrossed mind is shaped by unwanted, mischievous desires, attachment for wife, children, and other such illusions bring about the defeat of human life. So he's really telling them it straight. The illusions of family life, family happiness, material life will just imprison you further in material world. If by divine arrangement a person reaches the stage of pure devotional service to the Lord, realizations dawn with him so that he gradually becomes detached from material life. But instead of devoting himself to the worship of Lord Krishna, if such a person returns to materialistic life, his mind will again become contaminated by capricious, mischievous desires. So we can fall back down, we can develop this devotional consciousness, but then we can lose it by bad association. I do not want you to remain prisoners forever. I hope that you develop a distaste for material pleasures. Please chant the holy name of the Lord. I look upon everyone equally and wish the best for all living entities. I pray that you may develop unflinching devotion for Lord Krishna. Do not worry, for you will be freed in 2 or 3 days. When you leave, you may live in the forest or you may live at home, but always try to think of Krishna and cultivate spiritual life. Having thus showered his mercy upon the prisoners, Haridasa Thakura went before the Namah. Because of his purity, Haridasa Thakura radiated a spiritual effulgence that the Namah could not fail to notice. He rose respectfully and offered his saintly guest a seat. Although in a confused state of mind, the Nawab said, "What sort of mentality has overcome you? Even though you had the good fortune to be born a Mohammedan, you behave like a Hindu. You do not even accept rice that has been touched by a Hindu. Why do you reject your high birth and instead become a low caste Hindu? To discard one's own race, land, and religion and accept another is perverse. I have decided to punish you according to the dictates of the Quran so that you will be freed from your sins." So now they go on and Haridasa ends up being beaten. I think Maharaj must have talked about that. Yeah. So there's one more pastime. So Haridasa was beaten and abused, but they didn't actually kill him, even though he apparently died, because the people who were beating him would have suffered punishment for not having managed to kill him. So he feigned his death, but then he came back. And said that the Mohammedans that had tortured Haridas and their family were eventually destroyed. So the people who abused Haridas, their family, them and their families were all vanquished. So again, it's Krishna showing intolerance towards those who abuse devotees. So Haridas left that place and he went to live in a cave on the shore of the Ganga, the river Ganges. And daily he would chant a minimum of 300,000 names of Krishna. So we were discussing, isn't it, something like 172 rounds. It's just inconceivable to be able to chant so much every day. By the influence of the holy name and the presence of Haridas Thakur, the cave was transformed into a Vaikuntha planet in the spiritual sky. So the cave became like a wonderful spiritual atmosphere. But in Haridas's cave there lived a poisonous snake that emitted such strong vapors that no one could remain there for a moment, though there was a smell. Snakes are smelly. And this one had so much poison that you couldn't breathe the air. It emitted such strong vapors that no one could remain there for a moment. People came from the village every day to visit Haridas, but because of the snake, they could not stay long enough to speak with him. It's almost like a protection for Haridas. He wouldn't have to listen to all the blah, 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 blah. People might be telling him all the village gossip or something, asking him nonsense questions. And Guru Kishore's Babaji, he used to sit in a toilet, a latrine. He probably used this word latrine, but it means toilet, because he didn't want to be bothered by materialistic people, and they wouldn't go there because it was smelly. Okay, anyway. Still, Haridas Thakur was oblivious of his snake's presence, so he wasn't suffering. He wasn't bothered by the smell, or maybe didn't even perceive it. He was on a higher level, wasn't on the sensual platform. He was absorbed in love of Krishna. So he wasn't disturbed by the snake. Anyway, the Brahmanas discussed amongst themselves about the foul air, means the smell, and they consulted some Ayurvedic physicians in Puglia. Puglia is a place in Bengal. So they went and asked. These medical men strongly felt that Haridas should vacate the cave. Wouldn't be good for somebody to sit and breathe in all that toxic air. Yes, I think he should go. I think he should move somewhere else. Yes, yes. They were agreeing with each other. So joining the Brahmins, the doctors, the Ayurvedic physicians, doctors, they went with the Brahmins, they went to Haridas and said, because of the vapor created by the snake living here, no one can remain. You should go and find a suitable place to live. Haridas said, I have been living here for a long time. I have never felt inconvenienced by the vapors you speak of. Still, if you are distressed, I shall leave tomorrow. If it is true that the snake lives here, and if he doesn't leave by tomorrow, I shall find a new cave. Please do not worry any longer. My only concern is that do not waste your time in mundane talk. Every moment should be utilized in the topics of Krishna consciousness. So Haridas is so humble. He says, I'm not bothered by this situation, but if you're upset, I'll move. Let's see what happens to the snake, if the snake doesn't go. So while the Brahmanas and Haridas were thus conversing, the sun began to set. And much to everyone's surprise, the snake came out of its hole. So these animals usually come out at night, huh? Sun comes out at night when it's dark, but it's less likely to be seen. Its huge, frightening body had bright red, yellow, and blue stripes. And it was crowned with a brilliant gem. It was not an ordinary snake. The serpent slowly slithered past the brahmanas and left the cave forever. The brahmanas remembered Krishna as their only shelter, so they were scared. In other words, whoa, look at that snake, it's huge. And we have people, human beings, and also apes and animals, they have intuitive fear of snakes. If you see a snake, you naturally recoil. Because it's likely to be dangerous. So after the departure of the snake, the burning sensation caused by the poisonous air vanished. The brahmanas' respect for Haridas Thakura increased, for they knew that the Lord, Paramatma, had directed the snake to leave so that his devotee would not be inconvenienced. So Krishna didn't want that Haridasa had to move. So he told the snake to move. You move, you go. So Krishna can control the animals then, if he wants. So if we're bothered by animals, we can also just chant Hare Krishna. Krishna can take care. Or if we're meant to suffer, whatever it is, mosquitoes or rats or barking dogs or whatever it is, we have to accept. Because Krishna could change the situation or we could allow the situation to go on. So I can read one more pastime, or is that enough? I finished it. It's already 8:45. There's one more, it's indirectly about the snake. Okay? If anybody wants to go, but I will read this. There is another incident that was related by a snake charmer. One day in the courtyard of a rich man's house, the snake charmer was performing a snake dance by chanting a mantra to the accompaniment of musical instruments. So in India, it's quite common that you see snake charmers. They usually have a black snake. What is it called? Is it a viper? Cobra. Yeah, they have it in a basket, and then they open the basket, and then they play this kind of tune. Ooh. And the snake starts doing like this, coming out of the barrel. But usually they take the poison out now. So they milk out the poison somehow, or they remove the fangs or something, so it's not really so dangerous. But still, it's scary. I found it scary to see. I wasn't attracted. And then you're supposed to watch and then give a donation. And apparently in Vrindavan there's a whole community. People that usually they live in communities, you know, the bunnies live with the bunnies and the brahmins with the brahmins. And the snake charmers there's a community in Vrindavan across the water from Keshigad. There's a community of snake charmers. Somebody told me. okay. So he was dancing, chanting a mantra. So Haridas Thakura happened to pass by and he stopped to watch the dance. Although the snake charmer was an ordinary human being, by the influence of the mantra, he could dance as if possessed by the spirit of Anantashesh. So who's Anantashesh? Anybody know who Anantashesh is? Yeah? The Balaram, oui, mais en quel fond? Il a un serpent. Oui. Balaram takes the form of Anantashesh and coils up like this, and then Krishna lies on top. It's like a bed for Krishna. So this is completely powerful, transcendental snake, Anantashesh. So he's possessed by the spirit of Anantashesh, this person, because of the mantra. So with an enchanting melody, he sang about the pastimes of Lord Krishna chastising the Kaliya serpent, as another snake pastime. So he was singing about this Kaliya Leela. Haridas listened intently to the pastime of his beloved Krishna. Then suddenly, being moved by ecstasy, he fell unconscious onto the ground. So Haridasa is on the ground. And then Haridasa got up and he roared like a lion. He then danced in ecstasy while speaking incoherently. The snake charmer was impressed by Haridasa's manifestation of ecstasy. He moved aside out of respect. As he remembered Lord Krishna's merciful behavior towards Kaliya, Haridasa Thakur, his body trembled and he cried and then he rolled in the dirt. So Haridasa was manifesting this full spiritual ecstasy. People gathered there and tried to assist Haridasa by singing songs of the Lord's pastimes. Finally, when his ecstasy subsided, Haridasa left and the snake charmer resumed his performance. Everyone who witnessed Haridasa's ecstasies felt spiritually thrilled. They smeared their bodies with dust from his lotus feet. But there was a cunning and deceitful brahmana in the crowd who decided to try and cheat the people. So there was a brahmana who was envious and was watching this whole thing. This brahmana thought, I will also dance here. I can understand that people are not very intelligent. They offered so much respect to this low-born Haridasa just because he danced wildly and cried. If I, a brahmana, dance and cry, surely the people will worship me. So you can see what his motivation is. He just wants to be worshipped himself. He thinks, here's my chance. The brahmin threw himself onto the ground and feigned unconsciousness as if he had fallen into a trance. Seeing this, the snake charmer became furious. Picking up a stick, he began to beat the brahmin relentlessly until the pretender got up howling and ran away. The snake charmer then resumed his dance and the crowd was astonished. A man came forward with folded hands and said, my dear sir, why did you stand by respectfully as Haridasa danced and yet beat this brahmana for doing the same thing? In reply, the spirit of Ananta that dwelt within the snake charmer spoke in glorification of Haridasa Thakur. This is very confidential, still I will answer your question. When Haridasa danced in ecstasy, each of us felt spontaneous respect and affection for him. On the other hand, the brahmana was simply imitating Haridasa so that he gained cheap adoration from the crowd. It was not out of love for Krishna, but because of enviousness towards the Lord, pure devotees, that the brahmana threw himself on the ground and feigned ecstasy. Besides, he was interrupting my dancing, therefore I punished him severely. I remember once in the temple in Inishrath in Ireland, we had this man who was an Indian man, but that's not the point. He threw himself on the ground, was having spiritual ecstasies. It was bogus.
Yeah.
Oh, Krishna. And rolling around, you know. Mm. You see this in India sometimes as well, you know. Sometimes ladies, sometimes sovereigns, men. They do a spiritual ecstasy and everybody says, it's Bhagavati. They offer all respects, but the devotee doesn't do it like that. It doesn't manifest. I mean, Haridasa. Here he manifested spiritual ecstasy, but generally it's not done. Prabhupada did on very few occasions. But if you see somebody who's like 99%, likely that they're not the real deal. Anyway, that's it. I won't read any more. But it's a very nice book to read, Chaitanya Bhagavat. But you should read all Prabhupada's books first, don't you? You can read other books. Srila Haridasa Thakur ki. Srila Prabhupada ki.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
I have just some clarification. So Haridasa Thakur is Brahma.
Muslim.
Yes, but he's an incarnation of Brahma.
Yeah, it's supposed to be a combination of Prahlad and Brahma.
So, in that case, who's holding the position of Brahma?
Yeah, yeah, who's doing the job? There must be somebody. But I know that pure devotees can expand themselves and do more and more blessed ones. So it's possible that he was being Lord Brahma and also being Haridasa Thakura simultaneously. There are other examples of that. I can't bring it to mind immediately, but of people being. But I know when Vidura came, who was it? Somebody took his, covered his service, as we would say. I could find out for you.
This is just kind of bugging
me. Yeah.
How that?
Because we need Lord Brahma.
Yes.
We need Lord Brahma to take charge of all the things going on in the universe. Mm-hmm. So if he's not there, yeah, who's looking after the shop? Exactly, yeah. But I know the personalities like that he showed on how the Maharaj that can manifest as demigods. And also still be in the spiritual world as Krishna. So it's possible. But I'm sure if it wasn't Lord Brahma, yeah, disposed, I'm sure she'll get some arrangement was made, and not that Lord Brahma would be so irresponsible. But I will find out. I'll ask that question to my senior gurus. Okay. Sorry, Robert, did you tell? Tendry, I'll tell you how. Do you have any besides that really damaging to buy into the woman's dumpty? Daddy, the car, the sun's very big. There's nobody doing my car, you've got a good choice, but it's not going to buy the same money to power that. There's nobody to go. You were saying you wanted everybody to chant it, yeah? You want everybody to chant that sloka. It's good to do it because it reminds us of the prasad and the mercy of Krishna. And that we need the mercy to control our senses, otherwise we're lost. We'll be lost.
Haridasa Thakura ki
jai.
Haridasa Thakura.